Diabetes Connections is brought to you by the One Touch brand, providing diabetes management solutions for people living with diabetes, including the One Touch Vario Flex blood glucose meter and the One Touch Reveal mobile app. Taking a step forward starts with seeing where you are. And by Dexcom. Take control of your diabetes with the world's first continuous glucose monitoring system that sends glucose readings directly to your compatible smart device. Live life on your own terms with Dexcom. Hey, it's Stacey. This podcast is not intended as medical advice. If you have those kinds of questions, please contact your healthcare provider.
This is Diabetes Connections with Stacey Sims.
This week, Eric Paslay, Grammy-nominated singer and songwriter, diagnosed type 1 at age 10.
In a way, I think diabetes probably helped me pursue something crazy like this. You know, I was already like an outsider. I didn't fit in already in a good way. If I didn't have diabetes, I don't know if I would have ever gone out on a limb this far. And grateful that God still let me hang off the limb and not hit the ground yet.
We'll talk about the music business and how diabetes has influenced Eric's writing, as well as his involvement in Dexcom's Call of the Warrior campaign this month. Our community connection this week, the Beaties Bros. I saw these guys on Twitter and I had to learn more. And you'll meet Chris Pickering. He says it was tough to grow up with type 1.
The jokes, the jeers, the being left out of stuff. I grew up with a huge chip on my shoulder and it actually helped me excel in athletics because I had to prove a point to everybody that I wasn't just a diabetic, I was an athlete. And I don't want any other kids to go through that.
We'll talk to Chris about what the Beaties Bros is all about. And Diabetes Awareness Month, loads going on, plus shop talk this week with the Padre Foundation. It all starts now on Diabetes Connections. Welcome to another week of the show. Of course, every month is Diabetes Awareness Month around here, but I love hearing what you're doing, so let me know. And if you're new to the show, we aim to educate and inspire about type 1 diabetes by sharing stories of connections. Sometimes that means talking to celebrities or athletes, you know, names that you know. Sometimes it means talking to everyday people, I put that in quotes, who are touched by diabetes. So this week, we have a fantastic lineup. I am thrilled to bring you the interview with Eric Paslay. What a nice guy. And, you know, you find out diabetes is such a small world. I won't get ahead of myself. He's got a lot of great stuff to say. So it is Diabetes Awareness Month, as I said, a ton going on. You have probably seen a lot of the JDRF, T1D looks like me. You know, you can change your social media profiles and you can let your friends and followers know about type 1. I will put that in the show notes. Project Blue November, another great group that gives out terrific information. They're kind of like a clearinghouse. They started a couple of years ago. Some really terrific advocates who do a lot behind the scenes got together and made this group to get a lot of the information that's out there kind of through one place. So Project Blue November, definitely follow them on Facebook. They're doing something every day. I'll link them up as well. And something cool that a friend of mine on Facebook posted right on November 1st, and that's Mike Durbin, and he put out the hashtag Make Diabetes Visible. And I think this is so simple and so clever. A lot of people have already adopted it. We've been talking about it in the Diabetes Connections Facebook group. And if you're not there yet, please join us. That link, all these links are in the show notes. Very easy to find. And Mike's idea is just let people see as much as you want. Not every day if you want to, or once a week, or once this month. Let them see something that's going on with your life with diabetes and make sure to use that hashtag Make Diabetes Visible. So, Mike, thanks for coming up with that. Such a great idea. Mike's a very talented photographer as well, so he definitely thinks visually. All right, let me tell you about One Touch, one of our terrific sponsors. And One Touch has been a trusted brand in blood glucose management for more than 30 years. This year, U.S. News & World Report named One Touch the number one pharmacist recommended in blood glucose monitoring devices and lancets based on a survey of pharmacists nationwide. Find out more about One Touch brand products at diabetes-connections.com and click on the One Touch logo. Along with One Touch, another sponsor of the program is Dexcom, and I am so excited to tell you what they are doing this month. It is a campaign called Call of the Warrior. And for every Warrior Call photo or video posted in November on Facebook or Instagram with the hashtag WarriorUp, Dexcom will donate $1 to diabetes charities, including Children with Diabetes, JDRF, Beyond Type 1, TCOYD, Take Control of Your Diabetes, and College Diabetes Network. So what is a Warrior Call? Well, they put out an example. We talked to Derek Theler a couple of weeks ago. He is an actor. He is going to play Mr. Immortal in the new Marvel series coming out early next year. So here's a little bit of Derek's Warrior Call.
Diabetes is challenging, but it doesn't hold me back. With one simple act of solidarity, I believe that we can create a vibration so loud it will be heard around the world.
Yeah! And he's jumping in the pool and the dog's barking and it goes on, and it's a great video. You'll hear Eric Paslay's in just a second. But the campaign is that simple. You can do something fun like that. Benny's trying to figure out what he's going to do. He wants to involve the football team in some way, shape, or form. But you can also post a picture. Just use the hashtag WarriorUp. And one of the best things about the Dexcom system, I can tell you, is being able to send more information and communicate more clearly with our endocrinologist. The Dexcom G5 mobile CGM system gives you a reading every 5 minutes so that you can spot trends and get a dynamic picture of your blood glucose levels. At this point in the teen years, we are adjusting a lot. Being able to send our information through Dexcom Clarity to our endocrinologist makes appointments a lot more productive. Our doctor has more information relating to Benny's glucose levels. Managing diabetes, never easy, but I feel like we have one of the very best CGM systems working for us. CGM-based treatment requires finger sticks for calibration, may result in hypoglycemia if calibration not performed or symptoms expectations do not match CGM readings. For more information, go to Dexcom.com.
Music has changed my life. I love creating it, I love performing it, and I don't let type 1 diabetes hold me back. I'm a warrior, and this is my warrior call. Yeah, yeah. Now, let's hear your voice, warriors.
And that, of course, is my guest this week, Grammy-nominated singer and songwriter Eric Paslay. He was most recently on tour with Faith Hill and Tim McGraw, but he found time for us. Hey, Eric, thank you for joining me. Welcome to the show.
Hey, Stacey, thanks for having me. Yeah, we were just out with Tim and Faith and been doing all kinds of things. Just got back from the Middle East doing a Navy entertainment tour and had a show in the middle of Europe with Garth. And I've kind of been everywhere. I'm not sure what time it is, but I'm glad we're hanging out today.
You know, it's funny because you're there. Hey, Faith and Tim and oh, Garth, you know, can you take us back to when you were a teenager and you had these dreams? Did you really think this kind of stuff would happen?
I knew the odds were really bad, you know, I think every person kind of has something in their gut that says, keep going, you know, you know, I had this little CD player in my room, and I remember playing all kinds of records from just people we love. And it kind of is crazy. Yeah, we're doing an interview, and I'm like, yeah, Tim and Faith and Garth. Yeah, I know them, kind of, you know. And they're people, and they're really talented, good people, and it's cool to hang out. And it's just good to be able to chase your dream and have people not tell you no, you know, and say, hey, this is really, the odds are against you, but it could happen, you know, and I think just growing up with diabetes, in a way, I think diabetes probably helped me pursue something crazy like this. You know, I was already like an outsider. I didn't fit in already in a good way, you know, and I think I don't know if I didn't have diabetes, I don't know if I would have ever gone out on a limb this far and grateful that I, you know, God still let me hang off the limb and not hit the ground yet.
Well, let's talk about diabetes. Do you remember your diagnosis? I mean, age 10 is about old enough to know something's really different.
Yeah. No, I remember, I remember drinking way too many fluids and having, you know, blurry vision. And I remember getting sick. The wild thing is I do remember not having diabetes, but I kind of don't. It's just kind of always been a part of my life, feels like. And that's okay, you know, but I do remember and grew up in Temple, Texas, a great hospital there called Scott and White, and had great endocrinologists, Dr. Ponder and Steve Ponder and Dr. Don Wilson, just great nurses, and just really helped educate me on what I had and how I take care of it. And I think that's the biggest tool. It's like you have so many tools to use, from knowledge to devices to take care of your diabetes. And it's just kind of, I'm grateful I was diagnosed with diabetes now and not like, you know, 50 to 100 years ago, we'd be in trouble.
Oh, yeah. Well, if there's anything to be grateful about, it is the timing. My gosh, things have come so far. I'm going to come back to Dr. Ponder, because he has become quite a well-known and just influential person since you knew him as a kid. So let's talk. We'll come back to him. But were you already playing music when you were diagnosed, or was that something that you picked up later?
I wasn't. I mean, I think we had a school I went to had like musical theater, so I got to do that. So that's kind of, you know, pushed me out on stage a little bit and, you know, get you used to being in front of a crowd. And, but did that, I had like piano lessons, and like we had violin in school and kind of tinkered in all that stuff. And kind of, you know, I just always loved music. My grandfather was in a band, so I heard stories about him growing up. He passed away when I was young, but I always got to hear the story. So when I picked up a guitar, my family wasn't freaked out too bad. They were excited that I was kind of, you know, had caught the bug that he had, you know.
That's funny, because sure, in a lot of families, it's like, oh no, you know, stay in school, kid.
No, get a real job. Right. It's like, no, be happy with your life and hopefully you'll make a living doing it, you know.
Did playing music as a teenager make you happy?
Yeah, it's just fun, you know. You hear great music. I actually got to go see the Eagles this last week here in Nashville, and it was like, wow, you know. Just like such great songs and such great music, and you're smiling ear to ear. Regardless if you play music or not, it's just inspiring. There's something magical about music that words without a melody can't quite say, you know. And maybe, you know, you can take a lifetime to write 3 minutes of words. So you kind of get the right phrases down. But, I don't know. I just love playing music. I loved music, and I'm grateful I can make it, you know, and write it and kind of have that gift. I do believe it's a gift to somehow write a love song every day, you know, or write another way to say I love you, or another way to say I'm kind of pissed off, whatever you're going to write that day, or I miss you, or I can do anything, you know. But there's just so many cool things. It's just such a cool, I'm just grateful I get to be a creative person for a living, you know.
That's wonderful.
It's pretty cool. And you know, I think anything that you really want to become a master at can become a job, as far as discipline, but I still enjoy it, you know, so that's grateful for all that. I'm actually sitting in front of a computer right now. We're working on a record. You called, and I'm kind of mixing a song right now, and I'm having fun doing it, so it's great.
All right, so you know I'm going to ask, can you tell us anything about it, or will you circle back with me if that becomes a number one hit? Can you say we were on the podcast with it?
Sitting in front of it, trying not to mess it up too bad. Yeah.
I don't know why Stacey's name is suddenly written into the song, or, you know, I don't know how that happened, but
I love it.
Subconsciously. So, you know, one thing I thought of when you were talking about guitar, so many people with type 1 have issues, especially, this is, I guess, a question if you had been diagnosed for a much longer period of time, but I'll ask anyway. You know, fingertips get all messed up. I mean, even Benny, my son, you know, he was diagnosed at 2, and when he goes in the water sometimes, you know, the fingertips just look so kind of messed up. Do you have issues playing guitar with all the finger pricking and stuff?
No, I've always pricked on the side of my fingers. I mean, the honest truth with having the Dexcom that I wear, you don't have to prick your finger as much, so that probably saves the fingers. But I don't know. I mean, playing a guitar doesn't feel good at first. You get a bunch of calluses, so maybe maybe having diabetes just kind of numbed those nerves quick enough to where it doesn't hurt too bad.
Or I guess
it just kind of worked out good.
Or I should have asked, does playing guitar give you any problems with finger sticks, but you do it on the side? See, these are questions from someone who doesn't have to prick her fingers and doesn't play guitar.
Yeah, so. Prick on the side. If you're pricking on the end of your finger, dear Lord, it doesn't have to hurt that bad.
So let's talk about Dexcom, because they're doing this great effort in all the month of November. We'll put all the details out about this. But how did you come to start to use Dexcom? Was it recommended from a friend? Did you have your endo talk to you about it? Was Dr. Ponder getting involved here?
Yeah, you know, I went to a camp growing up in Texas, in Kerrville, Texas, called Texas Lions Camp. It's sponsored by the Lions Club. And that was so cool to get to go hang out with other kids with diabetes. Like, you're like, I'm not the only one, thank God, you know. I'm not the only kid that has to get up and go get a juice in the middle of class, you know.
Yeah.
And that camp just affected me so much, just as and even musically. I remember we would write songs there. You know, I had a camp counselor named Cody. He wrote songs and let me sit in with him, you know. But it was I actually got to go to Texas Lions Camp a couple years ago and play some music for the kids. And Dr. Ponder was there, and he's like, "Where's your CGM, man? Why haven't you gotten Dexcom yet? Like, just get one." He's like, "You don't, why? Why would you not have this? Like, it's good you have an insulin pump, but where's your CGM? Like, come on." And I think, you know, just seeing, and, you know, he's just like has great A1Cs and all this and that. And it's just really cool. And just had other friends that were wearing them. And I'm like, well, I knew that I had dragged my feet getting an insulin pump because I played baseball, and I was like, oh, it's going to get caught on something and it'll mess up and it's all this and that. And looking back, I should have gotten an insulin pump a long, long time before I even got it. But and it's the same thing with the Dexcom CGM. It's like, why have I not done this yet? So it was just encouragement from people that I trust and know that they really really know how to take care of themselves well, and I trust them, you know. And it's up to every individual, I think, of when you do it. But every time, every person I talk to, for the most part, is just like, why have I not done this sooner? So it's pretty cool. But I think through that visit and just through time going by and me realizing how stubborn I can be sometimes with change, that I was like, okay, let's do this.
You know, Dr. Ponder, as I said, has become really kind of a national figure. He's the Diabetes Educator of the Year. People may be most familiar with his book and his method, Sugar Surfing. We've had him on the show a couple times. We just talked to him about the efforts for hurricane relief in Texas, in the British Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico. What's he like? He wears silly hats. He looks like, I mean, he's got a beautiful granddaughter he dotes on. From your perspective, he's your Dr. Ponder.
He's just a good dude, you know. And I think what was so cool, and I think just what the cool this with Dr. Farnes, I wish no one ever got diabetes, but I sure am glad he did, because as a doctor and just the heart that he has, he really just comes down to kids' level in a way to teach them what it is and how to take care of yourself, and just the way that he carries himself. He's just so happy-go-lucky, good, and he's like, wow, he's like always on. I would never even know he's a diabetic. Like, I've never seen him go low or high. He's like, yeah, what's your blood sugar level? I'm coasting at, you know, 100 or probably at 95. It's not even at 100. You know, he's like got a better A1C than most human beings that aren't sick with anything, you know. And it's he's just a fun guy, you know, and really grateful. I just lucked out that somehow in Temple, Texas, he showed up there when I was one of his patients, and grateful for just all the work he does. And especially, yeah, we were texting during the hurricane and the islands and just the hurricane relief and all that. And it's just really cool what he's been doing and what they've been a part of.
Yeah.
Really, just really glad he's in the community of diabetes.
He'll be thrilled to hear that, I'm sure. That's such a nice thought, Eric. That's great. Talking about Dexcom, and as I said, this is a month-long initiative where Dexcom, the Call of the Warrior is what they're calling it, and they're donating money to different charities, and we'll link it all up in the show notes and at diabetes-connections.com. They're going to be helping the College Diabetes Network, TCOYD, Beyond Type 1, JDRF, and Children with Diabetes. We've both been to their conferences. Call of the Warrior is talking about facing challenges, you know, not backing down. What do you like about the Dexcom? How does it help you not back down? You know, to put it in this kind of campaign terms, does it really help you that much on the road?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I run around on a stage for an hour and a half every night, you know, and I'm not up there eating a granola bar or anything. I do have a glass of OJ usually, and we always have a glass of orange juice. So as a musician, as a singer, as a performer, it's you know, we're like out there in August in the middle of a farm, like sweating our butts off and, and thinking like, how have I not gone low yet? And the truth is, the coolest thing about Dexcom is you can share it on your phone. And I think that's just been, it's been a show saver, and it'll probably give me more life when I'm old to go, I get to live another decade because I've taken care of my blood sugar levels through all this, you know. And, but that's just my opinion. I think I will, you know, so I think I will. So I will, but, as a touring diabetic, it's mind blowing because my tour manager can be on the side of the stage. He has his phone. So my blood sugar levels go straight to it. So, if my blood sugar level's going low, he just talks to me in my in ears, and we have little speakers in our ears that we can only hear each other. So we're just cracking jokes, but he'll go, hey man, you're at 110, drink some orange juice. You know, oh, that's kind of our set level of, I'll catch a low before it happens around there, you know, and just kind of sip on some orange juice. And if I'm really crashing, the crowd just thinks I'm like really getting into it, chugging a drink up on stage. And I'm chugging some orange juice, you know, they're like, yeah, chug. And, but that's a long version of it. The biggest thing, it's been completely life changing because I can tour and I don't have to be afraid of going low, and I give the best show I can possibly give as a juvenile diabetic because I'm not going low on stage and I'm not high on stage. So it just works out great. And having my team around me and my wife happy at home that I'm not going low while we're on the bus and nobody knows if I'm okay or not, you know, sleeping in my bunk with the curtain closed. Yeah. You know, it just kind of, I think about that situation. I think about parents with kids, and I probably missed out on a few slumber parties because of that, you know, maybe the parents that you're going to don't know juvenile diabetes or signs of it and things like that. So, you know, as a parent, I can understand you would be freaked out about that. But with Dexcom, you can watch your kids' blood sugar level through the night if you want to be that OCD, you know, stay up and watch their numbers. But the best thing is it gives you an alarm. So, hey, you don't have to stay up. It'll wake you up. Yeah. Like it did this morning. I kind of slept in and heard the bink, bink, bink and woke up and there we go.
That's cool.
But it really is life changing. I just keep thinking I'm so grateful that I live right now and that I have the opportunity to use a tool like Dexcom and take care of my blood sugar level well. And you're taking care of just good vibes. Like people don't have to be afraid around you. Are they going to have a seizure in the corner again? You know, which that's never a fun feeling. I think any diabetic that's gone low in a public place or even when you go low in general, you kind of feel disappointed in yourself when you have a disease that can happen, you know, having a tool like this just makes sure you just have good vibes and you don't have to feel bad about having diabetes or cause a scene or just be a it's less of a burden on your family and friends.
You know, it's not really the topic of the show today, but not to get too deep, Eric, but I, as a parent, when I hear you say things, you're like, you're disappointed in yourself because you went low, or, you know, you don't want to bum anybody out because, you know, you're having ups and downs. It's so hard to separate the emotion and the mental part of diabetes because that's not you. I mean, that's the diabetes doing that. You didn't do anything wrong. And I'm just glad to hear that Dexcom's helping with that because as a parent, I just don't, you know, there's so much negative information that you're always getting from diabetes. You know, you have to do this, you have to eat better, you have to exercise more, you have to look at your numbers, you have to stick yourself, you have to go to the doctor, blah, blah. It's so rare to say, great job. I wish that there was more of that, you know, like the Dexcom confetti comes out or something.
Probably work on that, right?
I know, but I
gotta fill my confetti back up in my Dexcom.
But that's just one more thing
done
to do.
Good
I just
today.
Gave you one more thing.
I've been coasting on my goal level for over 28 hours. Keeps going off.
But I think it's important to at least acknowledge that even somebody like you, who's you're doing such a, you know, you're living this great life, you're traveling the world, and, you know, to say, geez, I don't want to disappoint anybody, I don't want to be a burden, you know, it's so tough. It's so tough. So I don't really have a question.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's just, I'm grateful we have it. And it really is. I wish as a kid and as a teenager, I had it more. It would have been, I would have been a part of more experiences. If that makes sense. Cause when you go low and when you're high and stuff like that, you kind of, you're present, but you're not totally present. Cause your body knows it's not, that something's wrong, you know? So it's just great to have this tool to soak up the memories as best as you can.
Oh, yeah. And I'll be nosy and ask, you don't really have to answer if you don't want to, your manager or your stage manager, the guy who's backstage with the share and who's you know, talking to you through the microphone, how much education did you have to do to the people around you, including him? You know, in other words, say, look, you know, 120 is okay, 70 is not great, you know, don't panic if you see me eating this or doing that. You know, how hard is that?
I think it's just, you know, being around and people, I mean, we live on a bus together, you know, three or four days a week. And it's just educating on, this is what insulin does. This is what sugar does to your blood sugar level, and high and low means this. And as a diabetic, it is confusing because it just seems like common sense of like, well, yeah, my blood sugar level's high. I need some insulin.
Right.
You know, because a lot of people are like, man, you're low. Give them insulin. No, don't kill me. You know, but it's just educating and just kind of little analogies I do to talk about what does what in the body and what numbers are good and this and that. But it is awesome on the app where it's like has the arrows. It's like, I call it like the GPS of blood sugar level. It like gives you the arrow of you're going straight across. So you're just cruising great. You're sugar surfing like with Dr. Ponder, you know, or you got the arrow diagonal down, like I should eat eventually, or you have down arrow, which means I really should eat, or you have double down arrow, which means I need to go get some orange juice or something really fast in me. But it really is amazing. Or I have double up arrow, I need to go change my infusion site or something, you know, all kinds of things. And with people that don't have diabetes, they're like, what is this guy saying? So I think it's just being around diabetics and educating them, but my guys are just on it, and it really is. It's as long as you're open to learning just a little bit, it's really not too hard to understand kind of highs and lows of diabetes.
Yeah. With that education, I've seen a lot of pictures of you and articles. You mentioned going back to camp with you going and talking to kids. What's that like for you? You know, being diagnosed as a kid, and then I mean, there's such cute pictures. The kids are surrounding you and they've got their Dexcoms or their pumps or their pods and you're all smiling. Is that more than a photo op for you?
Absolutely. I mean, is it a photo op? Yay. I just think I've been given a gift of music and a pedestal to just kind of help people have good vibes and encourage them to take care of themselves. I think it's, as a kid, you can get really frustrated with it. And I'm grateful I was diagnosed at 10. If I was diagnosed at younger, like your son, he doesn't know what it's like to not have diabetes. And I'm sure he's on it, but I know other diabetics that when certain drinks start showing up when they get older, they might go off the deep end because they're like, I'm fine. I don't have diabetes, you know? And I think I just like going and encouraging kids like, hey, just be the designated diabetic. It'll help you get out of a bunch of situations, you know, like I'm designated diabetic. Cool. Don't kill me. You know, all your friends will be like, don't just give them water. Give them water. But and still having fun with it. But on the side note of that, all the college kids need to listen to that part. But, you know, it just really is special to get to go sit in front of kids. And I think in our society, being a musician is like so cool and a rock star kind of thing. And hopefully they look up to me in a way, to where they'll listen to me to take care of themselves and not be afraid to say, hey, I'm low. Like, especially, I remember as a kid in the classroom, I was always afraid to speak up because I didn't want to like interrupt the teacher or something like that. When I'm like, I can just feel my blood sugar level crashing, and it's just like, speak up and go to the nurse and take care of yourself and listen to your doctors. And if you're frustrated with something, let them know and figure out and talk through it and learn and figure out what foods do this to your body and everything. It's a long journey, but I think that's why you need people to encourage you along the way. And it's really special that these hospitals and camps open their doors to let me come play some music for the kids and tell them, you know, you're doing a good job and keep doing it. And, don't be afraid to ask questions and to take care of ourselves, and don't be afraid that you're not like everybody else. Nobody's like everybody else. You know, we all have our things. We all have our burdens. And with type 1 diabetes, we have diabetes. That's just part of our life. And guess what? We're still living. And that's amazing, you know.
Do you feel like diabetes has ever come out in one of your songs? I mean, not that you've mentioned it explicitly, but, you know, that it's influenced any of your writing?
Yeah, I wrote a song called Give Me Some Sugar, Baby. No, I'm kidding. I remember when I was diagnosed, the nurses came in and gave me a shirt that said, Kiss the Diabetic, it's the only sugar they get. And it probably helped start me get going. I go, hey, that's a clever way of using words. But I don't know. I think I've never, like, written a song for diabetics or anything like that. I mean, there's, like, what, 30 million of us. Maybe I should.
Well, I just meant, you know, too, growing up that way, you know, as you said, you've been in situations that most young people don't find themselves, making decisions like, do I interrupt my teacher, finding others like you at camp where you felt alone before. So I didn't mean, you know, specifically writing about type 1, but I just think it comes out in ways that you may not expect, you know, when I've talked to other artists or writers. Not to get too deep on you, Eric.
No, I'm a songwriter. Shoot, I love getting deep. It's fun. Rabbit holes are fun, you know.
Right.
I think the coolest thing, I do agree with you. I think I definitely try to write songs a lot of hope and not giving up and pursuing your dreams and just not letting anything get in the way of what you know you're capable of doing. And I think for everyone that has whatever dream it is, that doesn't mean you need to be a famous person. I think too many kids are taught that. We teach kids be famous. It's like, no, do it your love, and whatever side effect of that may be. Maybe it is fame. I don't know. But I think in my songs, diabetes has helped me write a lot more hopeful songs and probably a few more, not as many drinking songs, that's for sure. I can't go get wasted. No, it's a terrible idea. Yeah, freaking seizure in the corner. Party foul, man. But it's fun.
That's funny. Before I let you go, I'm just curious. Do you have a favorite song that you've written for someone else, or that you love performing? Is there a song that you just look forward to in your set when you perform?
It's always great when people sing back. It's just kind of I call every hit like that a million miracles, because just the odds are terrible, you know, and the fact that happens, it really is a miracle, because great songs are written every day here in Nashville and around the world, everywhere. And the fact that people get to hear it and then that connection happens with the crowd is just amazing. But there are, you know, there's special songs that come along that aren't always going to be on the radio. And I think, it's just kind of a funny thing for musicians. There's the light isn't always going to be shown exactly on what you want to be shown on. But I think as long as your heart's and everything you do, little bits and pieces will show up, you know, through the years and through the songs. And there's a song I have called Deep As It Is Wide. And we were I actually saw a lady named Cheryl Crow who I got to sing with on it. And there's a story. About, I don't know, 4 years ago, I was making my album, and Amy Grant was recording her album at the same time. We were using the same producer. And so I'd be in the studio, and then I'd be wrapping up, and she'd be coming in to, you know, sing some vocals or whatever. And she's just a lovely person. She said, Eric, that, you know, that song, Deep As It Is Wide? And, you know, I'm just like, uh-huh, you're Amy Grant. You know? She's like, I love that song. I was like, can I put that on my record? And as a songwriter and as a singer, I, a lot of people are like, why are you giving away all your hits? Which is a fun thing, because it's a catch-22. It's like, well, it's a hit when they play it a lot, you know?
Yeah.
but that was like the one song that I was holding on to for myself, for my album. And she was like, no, I want you to sing on it with me. Like, I want you, it's like, there's three verses on this and you really need to sing on it with me. She's like, can I call one of my friends to see if she'll sing it? And sure enough, she calls up and I hear Cheryl Crow's voice. And I just saw her last night, which is so cool. And I always tell her, thank you for being a part of that. But that song is special to me, not just because it got to capture, I think, just a song full of hope and what I believe in and just good vibes. And the fact that, you know, heaven sometimes lets you catch a cool song. But the fact that two incredible singers, incredible hearts, and just great, inspiring people allowed me to come sing on a song with them. And I remember Vince Gill was playing guitar behind me.
Oh, my gosh.
Guitar parts were good enough. Like, you know, one of the Eagles members now. You know, 21 Grammys. He's won like 20. It's just crazy.
Oh, man.
But the cool thing, that song's special to me because at that time in my life, I hadn't had anything recorded. I hadn't had any success as a singer. And I think God was just kind of saying, kid, keep going. You know, these people dig it. Keep going. Don't give up. And I hope that I'm that to young diabetics when I get to show up and say, hey, to encourage them and tell them, keep going, not with just diabetes, but what you believe in and what your heart really longs for and to not give up on that and not let diabetes get in the way. I think it honestly is a great tool to help give you strength when the rain's coming down, you know, and to know that you can survive survive anything. And, as long as you're doing everything for the right reasons. And, I'm grateful I get to talk to you about diabetes because I'm not ashamed to have it. I wouldn't mind if it went away one day. You know, I don't know. I actually don't know what I'd do with myself. What would we talk about?
Oh,
I mean,
you know what?
People are just tired of me talking about music.
If that happens, I'll call you back. We'll figure it out.
We'll figure it out. Let's do that.
I don't think we'll have trouble. Eric, thank you so much. It was fantastic to talk to you and to get to know you. I really appreciate it. And thanks for everything that you're doing with Dexcom and all the charity that's going on this month. It's just so terrific, and I really appreciate your time.
Hey, Stacey, thank you so much. Thanks for doing what you do. This is great.
What a nice guy. And isn't that a great song? I mean, what a great story to have two people that you look up to, so talented, superstars, singing your song with you. I love it. I'd love to have him back on sometime. More information about Eric, where to find him on tour, the Warrior Up campaign with Dexcom, all of that in the show notes. And again, if you are listening on any podcast app, should be very easy to find the show notes. Just click it. Sometimes you have to say click here for more or full episode notes. Apple podcast app is changing, I feel like, almost daily. It's a little complicated to find things sometimes. But if you have any issue or if you're listening on social media, come on back to the website, diabetes-connections.com. All the information is always there, and you can always reach me on social media. My community connection this week is the Beaties Bros. Have you heard of these guys? They're on Instagram and Twitter. And I was really excited to catch up with Chris Pickering. Chris and the group here really stepped it up when the hurricanes came through. They're based out in Oklahoma, and they really wanted to help out. And it turned into something, I think, bigger than they really even expected. But I'll let Chris tell you that story. So here is my interview with Chris Pickering from the Beaties Bros. Chris, thanks for joining me. I am excited to learn more about your group. Is it the Beaties Bros, the Beaties Brothers? How do you say your foundation?
Well, it can go two different ways, just depending on what part of the country you're in. Down here, we talk a little slower every now and then, and everybody calls it the Beaties Bros. And great thanks to Wilford Brimley on that terminology now. But everywhere else, it's the Beaties Bros.
Wait a second. I thought we were going to be talking about bros versus brothers. People where you are, you're in Oklahoma City, they still say Beaties?
Yes.
That's funny. So what is it? So what is the Beaties Bro Foundation? Bro, I know I can't say it at all. So what are you all about?
Our whole goal is to inspire a community, and two different aspects involved with that. One of the first things we want to do is we want to inspire the diabetic community to get out, get active. We want to inspire the general public to get out, to learn about diabetes, learn the early warning signs, and, you know, especially dealing with things like DKA. So that's with events that we're going to begin doing, and just through all our social media resources, we're just spreading as much awareness as we can and having as much fun in the process.
So how did this get started? Chris, what's your story? You know, when were you diagnosed?
I was diagnosed in 88, and I literally got released 2 days before my fourth birthday so I could have a normal birthday party. And so now going on, you know, almost 30 years living with diabetes.
Do you remember that fourth birthday party? Do you remember anything about it?
I don't. And I get asked all the time, what would I do with a life without diabetes? And I cannot give an honest answer because diabetes is all I've known my whole life.
Did you grow up knowing anybody else with type 1?
I am lucky and cursed with my family. I had a total of three uncles and a cousin who were all type 1 diabetic.
Oh, wow.
Now, two of those uncles have passed away, and my cousin has passed away, all from complications with diabetes. And I still have one uncle who's still living with it. So my family was very aware of what the condition was.
Gosh, that's got to be so hard in a way, as you've already alluded to, but also really comforting in a way. Do you have memories of your older relatives as you were growing up dealing with type 1? Because the management is so different now. I mean, in 88, you know, you really just were a couple of years away after home meters were okay.
Yeah, and that's talking to my uncles. My Uncle Mike, I did not know, and my cousin Lisa, I did not know. They passed before I was born. Mm. But with my Uncle Daryl and my Uncle Terry, who is now still alive, the stories they have told me from glass syringes that had to be hand washed, you know, the doctor's visits and how lengthy they were, just everything. You know, I grew up in a time that RNN were still fairly new insulin, and that was the new great thing. Mm-hmm. And here we are now with all the true fast acting insulins. And you look back on it, and it was like we were in the dark ages at that time. And so I can't imagine for anybody in the 60s, 70s, or even earlier than that, living with type 1.
So you're diagnosed, gosh, 30 years ago? I'm trying to do the math.
And yeah, as you say, almost.
Yeah. And as you say, a lot has changed. Do you mind if I ask what kind of care you use now? Are you MDI? Do you use pump? Do you use a CGM?
I am all on injections, working towards a CGM and eventually going back onto a pump.
You said back onto a pump. Is it something you had a bad experience with? Or
I was part of a recall on insulin pumps back, oh gosh, about 15 years ago now. And I have just been scared to go back on one ever since.
Yeah. I have a friend who tested an insulin pump when he was in eighth grade, which would have been, probably in the mid to late 80s, early 90s. And he said it was just a nightmare. And it took him until he was in his 40s to try an insulin pump again. So, yeah, that makes sense. So you guys have been really busy, though, not just where you are in Oklahoma City. You've been really busy with the relief efforts for Houston. And we've done a couple of podcasts on that. You know, the situations in Puerto Rico and in Florida and in Houston with the hurricanes. How did you get involved in that?
It was purely by chance. We had some people on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook reach out to us, and they're like, you guys are very close to Texas. Are you guys doing anything? Mm-hmm. And when we started receiving these messages, we had absolutely no game plan on how to help. And so we just put out some tweets and some Facebook messages and just asked our community around here, you know, if they have any diabetic supplies, to please let us know, and we will get them down there. And we actually started receiving supplies before we had a plan on getting down there. Mm. And we lucked out with our local radio network here that they were asking their listeners. And altogether, we received about $30,000 worth of supplies, and including an Omnipod for a family down there.
So wait a second. Tell me a little bit about the radio station. Was this a group, radio stations, as they do? You know, I used to work in radio. They'll do fundraisers or bottled water or things like that and get it to where it needs to go. Is that something you were able to join in on? And what was the station? You can definitely mention them.
It was with Tyler Media. And it was just, we're pretty good friends with quite a few of the hosts across their network. And, you know, just reached out to them. Was like, hey, guys, this is what's going on. Do you mind, you know, giving some shout outs and seeing what happens? And our friends, especially on the Franchise Sports Network, that's my go-to every day that I listen to, and just ask the host of the shows. And they did. They they would ask on air. They would also send out tweets saying, this is what we're doing and how you can help. And we just got flooded with diabetic supplies.
Power of radio, man. It's just such an incredible thing. It really is.
Absolutely.
So did you head down there? Were you able to interact with the people who were receiving what you sent?
Unfortunately, we were not. As early as we went down there, there was still quite a bit of flooding or standing water all over Houston. So we couldn't make it in as far as we would have liked. But we did. We had a chance to meet up with Ann Ember and Kelly Champ Crumpler and T1 Team Texas down there and got all the supplies. And we heard some of the stories and we heard about some of the families asking for help. And we got everything we could down there. Now in contact with Dr. Ponder almost on a daily basis at this point to get as much as we can going down to the Virgin Islands.
Wow. Yeah, that effort has been absolutely incredible. That's a pretty tight community down there in Texas. I have learned it's pretty incredible when you think of what they were able to do in a short period of time.
Everybody down there in Texas are just phenomenal. They welcomed us with open arms. You know, one of our big fears was that we're not going to be able to help enough. And they're like, you're helping more than we could have imagined. And it was just, you get that feel good going on that you're actually doing something for a greater good. And it was just beautiful. And another thing that came out of that is now we are working with members of the Houston Rockets organization on our next trip down.
Oh, that's great. So tell me a little bit about Nate, right? He's your partner in all things Beatty's Bros. Who is he? What's his story?
Nate he has been type 1 for around 20 years now. And he was diagnosed a little later in life. He was late teens, early 20s. And I have to look back exactly when it is. But he is actually a special effects artist for films, movies, TV shows, commercials, and just does some amazing work.
Oh, wow. What kind of shows? Can you tell us like a couple of shows we might have seen?
The Veil that has just been released is a somewhat kind of medieval fighting. I can't really explain it properly, but that is one he's worked on greatly. I met him through my wife, and that's the movie they met on. And that's how we've got connected. And then his newest release is a movie called Gremlin. It's a little darker movie, but it's still a very, very good movie. And he did some amazing work on that one.
Cool. Yeah, that sounds really interesting. I'm just nosy, obviously. That's why I like to ask these things. So you guys are all over Twitter. You do a lot of social media stuff. Before you got involved with the Houston effort, I know that you had been planning some events coming up. And, you know, this is obviously changing things in a good way, as it should. But what are you hoping to accomplish, you know, maybe when things settle down a little bit?
One of the biggest things is creating the community events. And with a community event, we want them to be open to anybody and everybody. So again, you know, going back to the two things that we want to accomplish, getting the diabetic community and the general public together. And that's how we want to do it, is through these events. We luck out with, we've got a great friend of ours who has bounce houses that they are willing to donate their time for any event that we do. Also, food trucks are becoming just largely popular across the nation. And some of our great friends own the food trucks around the area. And all these organizations have said they are willing to donate their time and their efforts to come out and help our events. So that's going to be the goal with 2018. We've pushed all the events that we had planned into 2018 at this point to focus on the relief efforts. And going into next year, we want to have quite a few events. And with the connections now that we have in Texas, we'd like to not just stick in Oklahoma, but begin branching out into Texas and eventually take this cause, you know, nationwide and who knows, maybe worldwide at some point.
So why do something like this? I mean, it's enough to keep yourself healthy, you know, make a couple friends along the way and help out, you know, when you can. But why do something that, honestly, it's going to take a lot of work? I mean, these things are fun to put on social media, but for what you're talking about, it's a lot of time and energy for you.
One of the biggest things for me, I am big on kids. I absolutely love kids. And, you know, I've got four of my own. And just knowing the hardships I had growing up with diabetes, the jokes, the jeers, the being left out of stuff. I grew up with a huge chip on my shoulder, and it actually helped me excel in athletics because I had to prove a point to everybody that I wasn't just a diabetic. I was an athlete. And I don't want any other kids to go through that. And that's, you know, why we're working on so many great connections right now to show these kids, you know, and even adults. And I don't mean it to be just about kids, but, you know, the adults that are newly diagnosed, that it's not the end of the world. You can do so many great things with it. That's what we want to bring to the table, is that diabetes is, it's a life altering situation, but you can still live a great life with it.
Do you worry about your own kids? You have 4 kids.
Oh, constantly. Every time that we have to have an emergency room visit, or we have to just go to the doctor in general, I tell them, check, you know, let's test, let's make sure everything's going well. And luckily with our pediatrician, she's been a great friend of the family for many years now. And she knows that when I come in there, that she's going to go ahead and run the test and make sure.
Well, yeah, because God forbid it happens, you want to catch it early.
Exactly.
Oh, man. I just think this is great. I love what you're doing, Chris. I hope you keep coming back and talking to us. I'd love to check in periodically and, you know, find out what is going on. And one of your pushes in Oklahoma City needs to make it so that people say beaties and not babies or boot, whatever they were saying. I love it. Thanks for joining me.
Stacey, thank you so much.
I couldn't even say beatus. I mean, I knew what I was trying to say there, right? Diabetes, beatus bros. But yeah, it doesn't even want to come out of my mouth. I love that. So you'll be hearing more from Chris, I am sure. And all the information about the group is linked up, easy to find in the show notes or on the website. In the Shop Talk segment today, yeah, I love hearing that music because it means I get to bring you an exhibitor from a diabetes conference. One of the cool things about going to these conferences is meeting terrific people, but also seeing, you know, products and exhibitors and cool people who travel. And if you can't get there, I want to bring this to you. So I've been doing this for a couple of months now, and Shop Talk today is with the Padre Foundation. Now, this is a group that is local to California, but I think we could all learn a lot from what they're doing. So here is Shauna Baker with Padre.
We serve approximately 2,500 families in the Southern California area that have type 1 diabetes.
And when you serve, you mean, is it foundation? Is it community?
So we serve children and their families to help better manage their diabetes. So we have 75 educational classes, and including psychosocial, a year. We have camps such as Catalina Adventure Camp. We have our winter and summer camps, surfing with diabetes. We hold a nurses forum so that, like, all the nurses from all the school districts can better understand how to manage a child with type 1. So it's really about the here and the now until, you know, eventually, hopefully, there is a cure.
What can other groups learn? I mean, I'm in North Carolina.
Okay.
So I don't know that there's an equivalent of something like this. What kind of message do you hope to spread?
Well, what we would like to see is, you know, how we've developed our foundation is, it was just a parent that had a child with type 1 30 years ago. And with that, we've kind of, you know, we've got attached to Children's Hospital of Orange County, but, you know, it's just really the finding those connections. You know, we collaborate a lot with JDRF and with ADA, and if you collaborate and you partner with other organizations, and then just further connect families to other families so they don't feel alone. And that's what our message is just so no child with type 1 feels that they are alone or going through this, and not having the support and not having the confidence, I guess. And we instill that in our kids.
Do you have a connection to diabetes?
So my nephew was diagnosed at the age of 3, and he's almost 8 now. He's been on the insulin pump for 4 years. And I'm going to summer camp for the first time this summer by himself. And it's so funny. He said, Auntie, he said, I'm almost afraid of a cure. And I said, why is that? Because, you know, he keeps saying he's going to get the cure. And he said, because I'll lose all of my friends. And I said, well, you won't lose your friends. They'll still be there. But, you know, it's there. We do so much good and so much fun for the kids, you know. An event almost once a month, and so it really connects the kids, and so they feel like they don't, you know, they don't want to miss that, you know, if there is a cure. So it's a win-win.
You're listening to Diabetes Connections with Stacey Sims.
Thanks to Shauna for sharing that story. That's really good stuff. And more about Padre, of course, on our website. And, you know, if you're interested in starting something like that, it really, honestly, all it takes is somebody who wants to do it. I mean, that is really all you need. You don't need any special skills other than raising your hand, saying I'll do it, following up. Well, I guess those are special skills. It's not easy, but I'm always thrilled to meet the people who make it happen. I would love to share your story. Please let me know what's going on this Diabetes Awareness Month and, of course, you know, all year round. And join the Facebook group. It's a terrific way to get to know other listeners, to talk about what's going on in your community, to make requests of the show. Who do you want to hear from or about? You can always message me over social media. We are on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram as Stacey Sims, and on Facebook and Twitter as Diabetes Connections. So I'm really pretty easy to find. Hey, before I go, I want to say a huge diversity shout out to Lauren Stanford, who has been living with type 1 for 20 years. And you may know Lauren because her mom is Maura McCarthy Stanford, who is a very well-known writer. She's been on the show several times. She's an incredible leader in the diabetes community. And Lauren is a tough kid. She's just a terrific person. And together, they are quite the dynamic duo. If you're not familiar with their story, I've brought it to you before. I will link up the episode where I interviewed Lauren and Maura. Lauren had some really tough years in her teen years and got through it and is now, she's just kicking butt as a young adult. And I know Maura's really proud of her. And Maura keeps, she's just, every year, her activism, her advocacy just grows stronger and stronger. They are remarkable. Yeah, I didn't want to forget about that. They've had a nice year. Lauren's sister, Lee, had a baby this year, so Maura's a grandma. So congratulations all around, you guys, and much happiness. Thank you so much for listening. I appreciate you so much. Thanks to my editor, John Buchanis, from Audio Editing Solutions. We have a lot of good stuff coming up. I'm Stacey Sims, and I'll see you back here next week.
Diabetes Connections is a production of Stacey Sims Media. All rights reserved, all wrongs avenged.